I'd like to invite John Jacobs, Vice President of Operations, Bob Bartosz, Senior Vice President of and CEO, COO of Dakota Coal Company, Mike Risen, Senior Vice President of Transmission, and Ken Rutter, Vice President of Marketing and Asset Management, to come up to the stage.
There's so many young staff in the group that have shown so much hard work and effort, and they've just been amazing to work with.
If you've developed the relationships, if you understand how they're operating, and if we have a requirement and we can explain our position, we'll have a good chance of getting something moved forward if we need it.
And they just asked me if I'd like to be on a continuous improvement team, and I didn't know a whole lot about it, but it sounded exciting, so I said, of course.
You always hope for the best, but plan for the worst.
That's been extremely interesting work, and it's kind of nice to be able to come to work and feel like you're making a difference.
But it went really smoothly. It was kind of anticlimactic, and a lot of hard work and preparation by everybody, not only in this department, but throughout the co-op.
Well, it's a big deal that they're allowing us to run this team.
Now, again, I just really believe that that agreement is a masterpiece in basic equity.
But I think it's been really good, the senior management team overall, providing direction on those things we need to get done.
The team building exercises have definitely helped us become closer as a team.
It's been an amazing experience. I would do it all over again if I could.
It's very dynamic, and it just kind of has a little bit more of a family feel to it.
And hands down, this has probably been the most fun year of my career, all the different things that I've been exposed to.
But again, I think it's been pretty effective.
And since we do have such a wide open environment, just learning to work with one another and kind of grow with one another as co-workers and also with people.
Working with the marketing team, the team is just awesome.
Yeah, I guess it's not so interesting to talk about a year that went without a hitch, but the year really went without a hitch.
We're just rolling with it. There's no stopping now.
It's been a great year.
Good afternoon. I have the privilege this afternoon to open the Operational Excellence Report. Bob Bartosz, Mike Risen, and Ken Rutter will also be presenting during this portion of the meeting. Operational excellence is about more than our physical assets. It's our employees, our cooperative culture, and our safety culture, our commitment to low-cost, reliable electricity. It's about ensuring our generation and transmission resources are well cared for and maintained so we can provide the highest quality of service to our members. Operational excellence takes fuel supply, reliable transportation, emissions controls, well-planned and executed maintenance activities, equipment updates, full environmental and regulatory compliance, effective and consistent employee training opportunities, and a strong understanding of market participation. Our current generation fleet consists of 4 base load coal-fired power plants, 1 intermediate natural gas combined cycle, several peaking power plants run on natural gas and oil, and wind generation. Over the last decade, Basin Electric's resources have grown in megawatts and diversity. Since 2005, we've grown by more than 800 megawatts of wind generation, complemented by as much natural gas peaking generation. Each of these resources come with different challenges with regard to operation and maintenance. As you can see, our generation mix in 2000 showed Basin Electric's portfolio was 85% coal. Today, though we've added additional base load coal facility, our Dry Fork station in 2011, as well as Class A member Corn Belt Power, the percentage of our coal resources in our portfolio is just over half our total resources. With our operating asset mix expanding, we must continue to adapt, train, and develop the best workforce possible to maintain operational excellence. Our focus over the last year has been in providing opportunities for employees to broaden their skills, training that engages employees and helps them feel empowered in their jobs, means employees won't just come to work to do a job. They'll come to work with a deeper connection to the cooperative and our members and a desire to find greater efficiencies and ways to improve operations. It starts the first few days working at one of Basin Electric's facilities, understanding Basin Electric's history and what it means to work for a cooperative, as well as providing employees the tools necessary to do their best, are all part of orientation and ongoing training opportunities. You'll hear more about these efforts tomorrow. Employees are our greatest asset. We need to ensure they can perform at their highest levels, and it's our responsibility to provide the training and resources to ensure they can. It's critical with our training to get people up to speed and working in our facilities. As in the past, operation employees would have had the opportunity and time to train in a job for years before moving into the next classification. In some cases, those years have turned into months, making valuable and appropriate training essential. It not only ensures our employees can perform their job, but perform it while keeping safety as a priority number one. We're continually improving. Our generation resources can't run without people who know and care about what they're doing. People will continue to be our primary focus, and we'll invest in the training tools and technology to ensure they feel confident and prepared for the jobs they are performing. Like our employees, each of our generation facilities is unique. In fact, none of our coal-based generation assets is the same as another. They have different requirements for operation, which in this world of one-size-fits-all regulation can challenge their efficiencies. Basin Electric's legacy units have been in operation for 30 to 50 years, and they continue to operate reliably and at very low cost. The fuel for the North Dakota units is supplied from the Coteau Properties Company, Freedom Mine, by our subsidiary, Dakota Coal Company. Our base load coal units in North Dakota and Wyoming also use lime and limestone from Dakota Coal's subsidiary and division. Bob Bartosz will provide an update on activities within Dakota Coal's fuel operations and its subsidiary, Montana Limestone Company, and the division Wyoming Lime Producers.
Thank you, John, and good afternoon, everyone. The primary focus of Dakota Coal's operations is supporting Basin Electric's coal-based generation facilities. Whether it's lignite coal for the Leland Oil Station, the Antelope Valley Station, or Dakota Gasification Company, or lime and limestone for the wet and dry scrubbers at the facilities, Dakota Coal provides and ensures Basin's baseload facilities have the necessary quantity and quality of fuel and products to be among the most cleanest, most reliable energy producers in our nation. The Dry Fork Mine, which provides coal to the Dry Fork Station, achieved some significant milestones this year. Last year, for 4 years running, coal from the Dry Fork Mine supplied to the Dry Fork Station was the lowest cost coal in the country. We're anticipating the same will hold true for this year, making that a record for 5 years straight. The second milestone achieved at the Dry Fork Mine happened in April of this year, when the 100 millionth ton of coal was shipped. Coincidentally, that 100 millionth ton was delivered to the Leland Oil Station. And this is the part that I really enjoy talking about, because I'm proud to say that we had another successful year with regard to our safety. In fact, in September, the Wyoming Lime Producers achieved 6 years without a lost time accident. Also in September, our quarry marked 1 year without a lost time accident. And today marks for the Freedom Mine 2 years without a lost time accident. Next month in December, our fine grind plant operations, along with the rail loadout, will achieve 12 years without a lost time accident. My congratulations to the employees at those facilities for achieving these outstanding safety accomplishments. In recognition of its safety achievements, the North Dakota Safety Council also awarded the Freedom Mine the Mine Safety Merit Award. The award is given to companies showing an incident rate equal to or less than the national average for their mine type. I'm proud to say that, award or not, the safety mentality has grown with the employees at each of these facilities. Employees keep safety a priority in everyday operations, as well as during the construction activities and the development. Wyoming Lime, which owns the Franny Lime Plant, is a limestone processing facility near the town of Franny, Wyoming, but it not only excels in safety, but also in production records. The Franny Lime Plant converts high-quality lime through a heat transfer process called calcination. The cooled lime is then crushed to meet customer handling requirements, and it is loaded into rail cars or trucks for delivery to Basin Electric's coal-based energy facilities for use in stack emission scrubbers, as well as their water treatment facilities. Lime has other regional industrial environmental uses. In addition to its safety achievement at the Franny Lime Plant, the facility broke an all-time production record through 2014 by safely producing 157,289 tons of lime during the year. The previous record was 150,832 tons, and that was previously set in the year 2008. At Montana Limestone's Fine Grind Plant, a new pin mill was completed this year and commissioned September 15th and 16th. The new pin mill was needed because our customer base has shifted to where the fine grind limestone is in higher demand. We needed a way to produce more of it. The pin mill makes the process very efficient. It has three rows of pins speeding around in a circle. The limestone drops in and is forced to go out through all of these pins. So there's one stationary row of pins and two moving rows of pins. It's a very good way to downsize the product. The capability to crush or grind and separate different sizes of limestone opens up additional customer opportunities for us. For example, crushed limestone goes to customers like the Leland Oil Station for its scrubber. But new customers that use limestone to seal asphalt need a finer grind, and certain sizes of limestone are sold as chicken grit and in other animal feed applications. The finest size of limestone goes to the rock dust market to be used in underground coal mines to keep down the risk of coal dust explosions. The limestone rock dust is mixed with water. It makes a slurry, and it is sprayed on the underground mine walls and then the ceilings. Because of the high demand for product at Basin Electric's facilities and our other customers, product transportation is more important than ever. Though our limestone, our lime, and our coal operations have had challenges in the past with transportation, the BNSF Railway has worked well with us over the last year to ensure consistency in product deliveries. Subsequently, the Basin Electric facilities were able to maintain appropriate stockpiles. Also, going into the past winter, the BNSF offered enhanced service to us, meaning instead of running two crews, they were running three crews for a few months at no additional charge to us. Joe Langang is Director of Fuel and Transportation for Dakota Coal, and here is his message.
Shout out to the Western Fuels Association folks, our partners, and folks to the other side of the table as well, the folks from BNSF. You know, we have much that we can find common cause with the BNSF. I believe that that contract, which gives us much greater predictability in terms of rates going forward, is also a masterpiece in in basic equity and fair-mindedness. Basin Electric and Dakota Coal Company fared better than most of the other utilities in the country. We had a good year. And again, the BNSF really stepped up for us. First of all, our inventory levels at Leland Old Station, which was a major concern for us, they brought those levels up. They helped us bring those levels up to where they're supposed to be, and they've stayed there. They really stepped up, and it was a tough winter for them. Secondly, our limestone campaign from Warren, Montana to Leland Old Station finished well ahead of schedule, as did our PRB, the Dry Fork Coal traffic to Leland Old Station. That also finished well ahead of schedule as well. So it was a great year.
Thank you, Joe. In addition to improvements in rail deliveries, improvements were made at the Freedom Mine this year. The mine's first drag line, the Sakakawea drag line, which has been running since 1983, had its boom and mast retired this year, and a new boom and mast were lifted into place. Since April, crews have worked to assemble the new boom and mast on a site that was developed for this activity. On September 15th, the new boom was lifted and pinned on the drag line. Here to talk about that is Travis Horning of Coteau.
We started building the boom and mast at the beginning of the year. They were built on this site here in place. And we went from there. On August 3rd, we walked the machine up onto the pad and proceeded with getting things reeved up so we could lower the boom, remove the boom from the machine, and then lower the mast to the ground, and then begin the work of removing the mast and pinning the new boom and mast on. There was some option. We've repaired the boom so many times that the iron is fatigued out and welded in so many places. And with the advantage of the longer boom and boom angle, the production that we'll gain out of it with the further reach and not having the additional equipment to strip the extra dirt that we'll need will pay off in the long run. We start with, in the cab, we'll have a meeting with electricians and the mechanics that will be on the machine while we raise the boom, discuss the plan for raising the boom, and then we'll go ahead and do a stall test of our motors to make sure our brakes hold so everything's safe. And then from there we'll come back into the cab, have another meeting, talk about safety, talk about all the things we need to watch, and we'll stage people throughout the machine. And right before we start, we'll do a radio check to make sure we have good communication with everybody at the machine, and then we'll proceed to raise the boom. The main thing is we watch is the drum with the hoist ropes or even ropes, the sockets that are fixed to the machine that are holding the boom and mast in the air. Them are our priorities, make sure that they don't slip. That's a automatic hold. So we're looking for major things that could cause damage to the machine. If it has no damage to the machine, we're gonna continue to go up until we're pinned. It's been a good project. Gone very well. Things have fit up very well. All in all, it'll be the performance that the machine will give out once with this new boom on it will be the huge benefit to everybody.
My thanks to Travis and the team at Coteau for this extraordinary effort. It took a lot of planning to make this thing successful, and they did a really great job, safely too, by the way. This new boom and mast will require less maintenance than the original. As well, it will allow our drag line to operate more efficiently because it's an I-beam, a wide flange boom, and it's consistent with the Marion-type booms. They are much, much stronger and durable. Also, the new boom is longer and operates at a lower angle, which should translate into greater operational efficiency and help to lowering our cost to produce lignite at the Freedom Mine. The drag line was turned back to operations by the end of September. In addition, the mine continues its reclamation activities, as well as staff have been reviewing the stream protection rule recently proposed by the Office of Surface Mining, Reclamation, and Enforcement. This rule requires surface and underground coal mining companies to establish pre-mining surface and groundwater conditions and then to return the mined land to those conditions post-mining. We will continue to study the proposed rule to better understand the impacts to our mining and our reclamation operations. Our core mission goes beyond supporting the cooperative's base load facilities. We're here to help Basin Electric's facilities surpass their operational goals. Before I turn the show back to John, I would like to say that this is my last annual meeting I will be attending as a Basin Electric employee, as I will be retiring early next year. With that, you need to know it's been an honor, it's been a blessing to be able to serve Basin Electric, my fellow employees, the board of directors, and the membership for 37 years. Finally, a special thanks to my wife and my family for their 37 years of support to allow me to accomplish my job. Thanks to you. Back to you, John.
Congratulations, Bob. As I mentioned earlier, each of our facilities is unique in its structure, its fuel type, and its emissions controls. Here's the representatives from the facilities to give you a more detailed report of this year's highlights.
I'm here in the new AVS ash pit, cell 4 at the Antelope Valley Station. We began using it in mid-September. Operation at the plant has been very good this year. We're at about 105% above budget generation. We had no planned outages, but we had some minor issues resulting in a few unplanned outages. Mercury removal equipment was installed last winter and spring to comply with EPA's MATS rule. Like the other generation facilities, AVS has the equipment to use powder activated carbon in both units. The pack is a very porous material that allows the gaseous mercury to be absorbed by the solids that can be captured and removed. Preliminary testing showed that the project will remove more than 50% of the mercury emissions at Antelope Valley. However, we are now testing an alternative option for mercury emissions removal. It's a new liquid product made by Nalco. We'll be testing it throughout the end of the year. If testing is successful, one benefit of the Nalco product will be the annual cost. It will be more cost effective than the activated carbon. Construction continues on the first segment of the 345 kV transmission line from Antelope Valley to Tioga, North Dakota. The portion of the line from Antelope Valley to Judson is scheduled to be in service soon. I'm here at Dry Fork Station near Gillette, Wyoming. Our governor, Matt Mead, was here this morning to announce that Dry Fork Station was selected for the Integrated Test Center project. We're very excited about it. I'm sure you'll hear more about it during the meeting. In fact, right behind us is where the test center is going to be placed. The plant ran well during the winter and summer peak months. I'm happy to report that through September, the unit was available 95% of the time. And while connected to the grid, the unit ran with a capacity factor of over 101%, or 426 gross megawatts. In preparation for the upcoming winter peak season, beginning in December, a unit outage was scheduled in September to blast clean the boiler and complete other repairs to minimize the risk of problems with the unit. In April, EPA's new MATS rule became effective. Dry Fork was well prepared for that. Upgrades were installed in the continuous emissions monitoring system. Both activated carbon and amended silicates are being used to ensure the plant meets the new stringent mercury removal requirements. Quarterly particulate matter testing also began in April with no concerns detected during testing. We've spent many man hours planning for the triennial outage scheduled for March and April of 2016. We're working hard, but we're keeping safety our first priority.
At the Laramie River Station, we are always striving to improve the efficiency of our units. As a part of those efforts, we're replacing air heater baskets, which over time will plug with ash, increasing the fan horsepower required to move the same amount of combustion air. In the past, we replaced them every 9 years, but found that the efficiency loss was too great, so we changed that frequency to every 6. We're also replacing the last row of blades on our low-pressure turbines. After 35 years of operation, Water droplets in the steam have caused some erosion with an accompanying loss of turbine efficiency. With regard to reliability, we've replaced the economizer inlet header in Unit 1 and plan to do the same in Units 2 and 3 in the next 2 years. We also completed replacement of the low-pressure turbine second to last blade row and ligaments in all 3 units. Cracking in the structure that held the blades could have led to a catastrophic failure event similar to one seen by at least 2 other utilities. We are also finishing construction of a new warehouse facility that you can see behind me that will allow us to properly secure and control plant assets, as well as right-sizing our inventory so that we have critical parts on hand while reducing non-value-added inventory. To meet the MATS, or Mercury Air Toxic Standards rule, we have installed powdered activated carbon mercury removal systems on each of the units and tuned our boilers to be very efficient at removing oxides of nitrogen. Since the first unit went commercial in 1980, we have lowered our NOx emission levels by 2/3.
Leland Old Station has been engaged in a flurry of activity over the last year. Last fall, we had an 11-week major outage in Unit 1, and this spring, there was a 10-week outage in Unit 2. Some of the highlights from these outages include installation of ports in the boiler walls of each unit for the mercury control system and the SNCR, overhaul of the Unit 1 turbine, and overhaul of the Unit 2 generator. I'm proud to say we were able to complete these outages, keeping safety as our top priority. Compliance with EPA's MATS rule involved installing an oxidizer and activated carbon injection system to control mercury emissions. This system was functional before the April 15th deadline. Construction began on installing the selective non-catalytic reduction project this summer. The SNCR is used for NOx emissions. The way it works is a urea slurry is injected into the boilers to work in conjunction with the overfired air. Computer modeling has shown that the new system will be capable of driving the NOx levels to below regulation levels, so we are very confident the system will provide superior control for years to come. The project is expected to be complete and running in April of 2016. One rule we are working to comply with is the coal combustion residual rule the EPA finalized in April of this year. Due to the age, construction, and proximity of our ash pond to the Missouri River, we have decided to close the pond to comply with this rule. The challenge is that the rule states Leland Olds must stop depositing ash into the pond by October 19th of this year. We hired an engineering firm familiar with large-scale dewatering to design a temporary system to be installed by the required date. At the time we recorded this message, we are 75% complete with construction of the temporary system, and we expect to have it functional on October 17th. The same engineering firm is working on preliminary designs and estimates for a permanent system, as well as requirements for the pond closure. These activities are expected to take place over the next 2 years.
I am happy to report that within the distributed generation, there were no dark cases in the past year. Our employees don't simply care about their own safety, they care about the safety of their fellow coworkers, and it shows. It's a credit to our people. Our teams have demonstrated great pride in their work and the cooperative's commitment to safety. It's our number one priority. Our employees take a lot of ownership in the facilities where they work. The distributed generation division grew another 90 megawatts in the last year with the addition of 2 combustion turbines at the Lonesome Creek Station. Additional generation means we add additional employees, which makes training in safety and plant systems a priority. We continue to focus on plant reliability. This includes additional routine turbine inspections, providing support for the balance of plant systems, and continual weatherization preparations. We hope Mother Nature is kind to us, but we realize extreme cold temperatures will be something we will always need to plan for and manage.
As you just heard, our operating fleet has a lot going on. Though it's still quite new, we've had significant change in how our fleet is dispatched since Basin Electric began operating in the Regional Transmission Organization, Southwest Power Pool, on October 1st. You'll hear more about this from Mike Risen and Ken Rutter shortly. Several of our base load facilities operated at or above 100% of budget generation. That level of reliability doesn't happen by accident. Our triennial maintenance outage schedule ensures our facilities are provided the care and attention needed so they can run safely and efficiently without significant issues. In addition, Basin Electric consistently maintains full environmental compliance. It's certainly not inexpensive to do so. As the chart shows, we are spending more and more of our operating budget on meeting and, in most cases, exceeding our environmental compliance standards. In the plant manager video, you heard that installation was completed this spring for new mercury emissions removal equipment at Leland Olds, Antelope Valley, and the Laramie River stations. The equipment is being used to comply with the Environmental Protection Agency's mercury and air toxic standards, which requires coal-based power plants to capture and remove determined levels of mercury emissions from flue gas. At the Dry Fork station, there was no need to install mercury control equipment because it was installed as part of the original construction. Dry Fork has been in compliance with the strict standards for about a year. Leland Olds has been in compliance since April, and the Laramie River and Antelope Valley stations since June. The plants use amended silicates and activated carbon to remove mercury. These materials are injected into the flue gas after it leaves the boiler and before it enters into the scrubbers. The use of amended silicates does not raise the risk of fire in the baghouse the same way too much activated carbon does. This is why, as Chad mentioned, the Antelope Valley Station is also testing a new product for mercury removal made by Nalco. It's not commercially available yet, but one of the benefits of it is more cost-effective than activated carbon and does not create the risk of fire in the baghouse as the activated carbon could. All these chemical and reagents ultimately cost millions of dollars annually at each of the facilities. That's just one of the ways we're working to find lower cost alternatives and solutions for operating our coal-based facilities, because as we all know, coal has become the punching bag within our regulatory environment. As you heard this morning, if you were able to attend the Clean Power Plan Town Hall, we're doing our best to figure it all out, but in the meantime, we're also stepping up to help reimagine coal generation. In his plant report, Tom Stalkup mentioned that Governor Matt Mead announced the state of Wyoming had chosen Dry Fork Station as a site for an integrated test center project competition, and you heard Paul talk about it earlier. Companies who choose to participate and are selected by the test center committee will have an opportunity to develop their technology at the Dry Fork Station and use flue gas to create carbon products. The XPRIZE Foundation is also participating. The competitor with the highest value product will win the cash prize.
This is about clean coal for America. What we wanted to do to address the solution is build an integrated test center. We wanted to see if we had an ability to capture a slipstream off a coal-fired plant and turn from what is viewed as a liability by many into an asset. It's right to be here in the energy capital, Campbell County, at this beautiful new facility with these great employees, to say to the county commissioners, to the mayor, to the state, to the world, ladies and gentlemen, Dry Fork Station will host the ITC. That's wonderful. Next is the funding issue. Legislature gave $15 million, but we needed to find another $5 million in matching. Tri-State has agreed to provide the entire $5 million match. That is remarkable. There's more. The National Rural Electric Co-op Association will provide an additional $1 million for the ITZ project, bringing the total funding to $21 million. Having the co-ops involved is so meaningful, not just in terms of the money, but in terms of their vision on how to find these solutions. The XPRIZE competition for coal will take place here at the Dry Fork Station Integrated Test Center. It's a $20 million competition. They will be our first tenants. And this is a heavy lift. It's a big challenge. But if we don't do it, who will?
This is an important day, as I said, not just for Wyoming. This is about America, Governor. Congratulations. Thanks to all of Wyoming for this. We're excited. We're ready to go. I know Tom and his team are. And so we just want to thank you again today. Thank you much, Governor. We appreciate it.
We are very indeed excited about the Integrated Test Center. Dry Fork will begin site work for the project during their outage next spring. As I mentioned, all of our resources have had a good year. Regarding the wind and peaking resources, they have also operated well and fairly close to forecast. I may be biased, but I think our generation assets are impressive. The fleet will always be the workhorses of the cooperative, but none of it would be possible without the workforce committed to safety. More than a year ago, Our Power, My Safety initiative began rolling out at the Basin Electric facilities. We have maintained an above average safety record across our facilities for many, many years, but that wasn't enough for us. Our Power, My Safety is a process of safety improvement over time with the employees in all areas of the cooperative as the drivers. It's a shift from safety program to safety culture. Here's a short video that describes how it works.
You matter. It's why your safety is so important to us here at work and at home. The Our Power My Safety process is a piece of our cooperative's safety initiatives. But how does it fit? First, it's not a program. It's a process. A process of engaging people across facilities to think differently about improving safety. It began with you. You shared what you wanted to see improved. From there, the steering team was created. This team takes your feedback and decides what initiatives to pursue and who will help guide them. Those guides are the Continuous Improvement or CI initiatives and teams. These teams decide how it will be done. Each team is working to improve their specific area of focus. They're not taking the place of existing programs, teams, or initiatives. They're simply enhancing them. It's a process of improvement, a piece of the bigger picture. A picture of safety that includes programs, initiatives, procedures, policies, and teams all working together to build a safety culture that begins and ends with you, keeping you safe.
We're very proud of the safety accomplishments over the last year, and it's only going to continue to improve. Our hope is that every employee will not only keep their own safety as a priority, but also the safety of their fellow coworkers. In addition to Dakota Coal's operations, the North Dakota Safety Council also honored employees at Lonesome Creek Station, Pioneer Generation Station, Prairie Winds, North Dakota, and headquarters with an award for exemplary safety. In April, the Lignite Energy Council honored the Leland Olds Station with a Safety Excellence Award for achieving a zero accident rate last year, tied for the lowest overall accident rate in the lignite industry in 2014. More impressive is the employees at the Leland Olds Station. All 166 of them have worked without a major workplace injury since October of 2006. In early August of this year, employees at the Leland Olds Station surpassed 2.75 million hours without a DART case, which refers to injuries resulting in days away, restricted, or transferred, and is a measure of the severity of an injury that occurs in the workplace. Safety is one of our core values, and thanks to our employees, those involved with the Our Power My Safety teams, and the sincere dedication I've seen across the cooperative, I'm confident that we will be successful in achieving a strong safety culture. Our employees care about each other, and it shows. As Mike Risen comes up, check out this amazing GoPro video of our transmission employees during live line training exercise this summer.
Dave Caswell, Williston, Juryman Lineman. We're down here this week for hotline training, which is right now we're going over some procedures with live line safety letdowns. And right now we're doing a spacer cart safety procedure where we let ourselves off the wire and off the buggy, off this live 345 line. I haven't done it on a live line. Knowing that it's live, it kind of puts a little bit more pressure on you than being a de-energized line, but you know, the basic features are there, safe precautions are there, and right now we're just, in case we do run into some troubles while we're maintaining these lines, we got the experience to come bring ourselves down.
Be tight, open the gate, and then you can move tight.
Coming down!
And that way,
Dave, I
actually, I think you have a better chance putting that on once you're in there, and then you can put your harness on right away.
There's that, you know, that 1 second where you got to trust everything you have and actually fall into your safety ropes. You know, there's that 1 second that crosses your mind that makes sure all your rigging's right. So,
all my rigging look good.
Our goal is to provide safe, secure, and reliable energy to the person at the end of the line. As this video shows, we have a strong culture of safety at Basin Electric that extends from the plants to the transmission department and all departments in between. The training video shown in the video involves self-rescue and conductor cart rescue exercises on an actual 345 kV transmission line near Beulah, North Dakota. Linemen also practiced a tower rescue of an incapacitated coworker, as well as hot stick procedures on different types of steel towers. These exercises are important because linemen need to know how to communicate and get down from line safely during an emergency. We have a dedicated crew of linemen who work in all weather conditions and, at times, at all hours of the day. No matter the conditions, they work tirelessly to care for the cooperative's growing list of transmission assets, and I thank them for their hard work. Brian Keller manages the Transmission System Maintenance Division. He'll provide a recap of his team's activities from this past year.
In the telecommunications equipment room at the Mandan TSM shop, which is one of 62 microwave sites in North Dakota and South Dakota, where staff has commissioned new microwave radios and associated equipment. Staff is presently transferring voice and data circuits over to the new system. The upgrade will provide the additional bandwidth required by new generating and transmission system facilities. Staff also placed into service a new microwave communications link between Laramie River Station and the Tekla substation to provide improved network connectivity between Laramie River and headquarters. Basin Electric was fortunate this past year. We did not experience any major weather-related damage to our transmission system, allowing us to focus on maintenance and the support of new construction. TSM line crews and mechanic operators relocated the two LOS 345 kV tie lines into new line terminals at the ABS 345 kV switchyard in support of new construction. The crews completed line modifications to connect the new Dry Creek substation into the new Underwood 230 kV line at the Rapid City DC tie. The crews also installed new transmission line structures near Williston and Dawson, North Dakota, that were required by highway construction projects. TSM substation crews installed and commissioned new equipment related to the additions at AVS and Charlie Creek 345 kV substations for the two new 345 kV transmission lines. During the Laramie River Station Unit Number 1 maintenance outage, TSM engineers and substation crews upgraded the protective relays, communications, and control systems for the three East MBPP 345 kV transmission lines. Through all these projects, our employees continue to work safely, with no personal injuries occurring this past year. TSM continues to incorporate the Our Power, My Safety process into our work activities. Our focus is on safety as we look forward to another safe and productive year ahead.
Whether by serving as boots on the ground in the field who keep our lines safe and secure, or by serving on the planning team, members of the transmission department are vitally important in getting safe, secure, and reliable electricity to our members. The planning team in our transmission department provides crucial foresight that helps the cooperative identify what is needed, where, and by when. They are actively engaged in studies and developing a strategy to meet the delivery needs of the membership. Basin Electric is in a unique situation as we are one of the few generation and transmission co-ops experiencing growth. While the growth in the Williston Basin is significant, our focus always remains on our entire 9-state membership. Our current generation and transmission projects are being built to serve all of our 2.9 million members. As the load in the Williston Basin has developed, we've been enhancing the transmission system to meet our members' needs. Here's a recap of the current projects. Construction continues to move forward with our Antelope Valley Station to Neset transmission project. This new 345 kV transmission line will be approximately 200 miles in length and will bring much needed electricity to the Bakken oil region. It's on track to be completed by the end of 2017, and we've recently reached a few project milestones. The section of line from Antelope Valley to Charlie Creek was energized earlier this fall, and the line from Charlie Creek to Judson is set to be energized later this year. The AVS and Charlie Creek substations are scheduled for final completion by next May, at which time the full reliability benefits of the AVS to Judson project will be realized. After the Antelope Valley to Judson section is done, construction will start on phase one of the North Killdeer Loop project. This project, which includes 60 miles of 345 kV transmission line and three substations, is being pursued due to significant load growth projected in North Dakota's McKenzie County in the 2016 timeframe and beyond. Phase one of the North Killdeer Loop project is scheduled to be completed by the end of 2016. Phase two of the North Killdeer Loop project and the Judson to Neset section of the AVS to Neset project are scheduled for completion by the end of 2017. Despite the decrease in oil prices and slowdown in oil activity, our transmission projects need to be done. Planning studies show we need them, no matter what. The dip in the oil activity is giving us breathing room to get them done. We also have some intense work underway in regard to the regulation aspect of the energy industry. The North American Electric Reliability Corporation sets and enforces standards that address the reliable operation of the electric grid on two fronts: operations and planning, and cyber and physical security. Basin Electric has assets in two NERC regions: WECC, which is the Western Electricity Coordinating Council for our Western System operations, and MRO, which is the Midwest Reliability Organization for our Eastern System operations. Last year, I told you about our preparations for upcoming NERC compliance audits. These intense audits happen every 6 years, with our last ones done in 2009 and 2010. Because Basin Electric has assets in both WECC and MRO, we will have two audits. Starting in 2015, the MRO has transitioned from an all-inclusive 6-year audit to a focused, self-guided quarterly audit. The traditional 6-year WECC audit for both the Critical Infrastructure Protection Standards, commonly called SIP standards, and for operational standards was conducted off-site 2 months ago. Our members in the WECC region participated in the audit by supplying documentation and being involved in the interview process. Preliminary audit results indicate we did not have any issues with the SIP standards. Several potential violations were identified on the operations and planning side. Basin Electric, compliance staff, and our Westside member cooperatives will be working together with WECC enforcement staff to complete a mitigation plan to resolve the identified issues. This process typically takes 1 to 2 years to complete. The other significant aspect about NERC standards is the recent implementation of a physical security standard and version 5 of the SIP standards, which goes into effect April 1st, 2016. During the WECC audit, SIP auditors conducted an outreach visit to us at Basin Electric. During their two-day visit, they provided guidance on the future implementation of the SIP version 5 reliability standards. This new version of SIP standards is very significant to Basin Electric. Essentially, under the version 5 SIP standards, we'll transition from not having any critical cyber assets to having a moderate level of critical cyber assets. This is a big transition that requires a tremendous amount of cross-cooperative coordination. Heading up this team is Mark Kinsler, Vice President and Chief Information Officer here at Basin Electric. Let's listen to him talk about the efforts underway to meet SIP version 5.
We're quite involved with the NERC SIP effort, which is Critical Infrastructure Protection. And in doing that, there's a large team of people from HR and finance, procurement, the physical security folks. It's a group effort as well as just the IT side, but there's many of us are involved with complying with the security pieces around NERC SIP and making sure that we have everything documented, that it's auditable, that we can prove we're doing the right things, because we are doing many things correctly, and we want to make sure that we get credit for doing that. And if our processes need to be adjusted in any way to fully comply, that we do that. A lot of it has to do with access management, where before we have not had to document both physical access, which is so card in, card out, from anything from data centers to substations, as well as electronic access. We need to make sure that that's all properly approved, that we have workflows in place to document the approvals and that we capture that, as well as entry and egress into controlled areas. But it's definitely a maturing process. We are trying to mature our controls, and I think the security effort is more of a journey than a destination. Not to beat that to death, but it really is. I don't think the standards are evolving, so I think our approach to the standards needs to evolve as well. It's not something that we can just check off at the end of the year and say we've accomplished this. And it feeds into both our financial audits. When Deloitte is in here, when Baker Tilly on the MVP side, we really go through a lot of our controls, and the cybersecurity is in the same vein as those controls.
Version 5 of the SIP standards will impact Basin Electric in many ways, right down to our employee level. Certain Basin Electric employees who have access to the Bulk Electric System, or BES, will be required to successfully complete and maintain a current background check. Employees impacted are those who will be provided authorized cyber access or authorized unescorted physical access to BES cyber-related assets or systems. Aside from a background check, to be compliant with SIP version 5, employees will also need to have quarterly exposure to security awareness information and annual security training specific to each employee's role. In fact, we're integrating this training with our existing learning management system our employees currently use. Cybersecurity exercises are a great way to prepare for a crisis and assess our procedures. Later this month, Basin Electric will participate in GRID X3, a GRID exercise for incident response involving players across North America. GRID X3 is meant to simulate a widespread event with rolling blackouts, and it will be great crisis preparation. Physical security is another element of the SIP standards that we need to comply with, and in response, we recently started enhancing security to our substations. The added security includes fixed cameras along the perimeters of substations, as well as pan, tilt, and zoom cameras that sit in corners for tracking activity within the substations. Control buildings will also receive fixed cameras, as well as door sensors, card readers, and motion detectors. All this new security, which allows remote video access at substations, can be used to verify identities, track time inside substations, and keep out intruders. Another change in regard to NERC compliance is a new strategic direction for the overall Basin Electric and member compliance program. Right now, Basin Electric is the only entity in our cooperative family that is registered with NERC in the two regions. We are transitioning away from this construct and are having some of our larger members who own a significant number of transmission facilities register themselves and be more directly responsible for their own NERC compliance. The big reason is that NERC compliance has developed into a much larger project, making it difficult for one entity to manage all of the pieces. But ultimately, it's a reduction in risk to all entities. We anticipate this transition will occur January 1st, 2016. I'd like to stress that our overall goal is to improve Basin Electric's operations, planning, and cybersecurity activities while promoting a strong culture of compliance. Thanks to our talented, dedicated staff, we're set to do just that. While this is a significant undertaking, it ensures the reliability of the bulk electric system and Basin Electric as a whole. Over the years, you've heard us talk about the Integrated System, or IS. But as of 1 month ago, we are now part of the Southwest Power Pool, or SPP. Our transition into SPP is a historical milestone for Basin Electric, and one that will impact how we conduct our activities. For example, in the past, we planned our transmission system with our integrated system partners, the Western Area Power Administration and Heartland Consumers Power District. Western also administered the IS tariff, which is how we recovered the cost of our transmission system. As a member of SPP, we will now plan our system on a broader basis as part of the SPP planning process. We will also recover the cost of our transmission system through SPP's tariff rather than the IS tariff. Western's roles in transmission planning and as the IS tariff administrator are therefore affected by our respective SPP memberships. As a result, our relationship with the Western Area Power Administration is also evolving. Of course, our relationship with Western, which extends back 5 decades, won't end here. It's evolving to something new for the benefit of those we serve. Just as our predecessors had the foresight to establish the concepts of the joint transmission system and hydrothermal integration for the benefit of consumers, we made the SPP transition for the exact same reason, for the benefit of consumers. The world around us evolved, and we needed to adapt. We at Basin Electric are grateful for all the work Western has done, and we couldn't have transitioned into SPP without them. Now I'd like to invite Bob Harris, Senior Vice President and Upper Great Plains Regional Manager at Western Area Power Administration, to briefly share the importance of our continued relationship.
Thank you, Mike. As I'm sure you know, the Western Area Power Administration's Upper Great Plains region is officially integrated into the Southwest Power Pool. The Upper Great Plains region went live in the Regional Transmission Organization the same night as Basin Electric. Even with all the testing, preparation, and hard work, I think we were all holding our breath a little bit that night. And though we're still learning, I'm happy to say, from my viewpoint, it's gone extremely well. I don't know if you know this, but Western's Upper Great Plains region is the first federal agency to join a regional transmission organization, so we're especially proud of how smoothly it went. I wanted to take a few minutes and make a few comments to acknowledge all the people and the effort involved this past year to prepare for this historic transition and to speak about our relationship with Basin Electric. Thank you to all the staff at Basin Electric and Western, as well as SPP. We did have hurdles to overcome before we could go live in SPP, but we were able to do it because of our staff's teamwork, dedication, and willingness to work extremely hard with the end goal in mind. It was a tremendous joint effort, one we should be very proud of. Regarding our relationship with Basin Electric, while many of the former processes we did jointly are not the same, I believe our underlying relationship with Basin Electric has not changed. That is, working together, keeping the lights on while providing exceptional service at the lowest cost possible to our customers at the end of the line. Working together and keeping our eyes on our end goal, doing what's best for our customers, we grow stronger, both individually and together. All the difficult decisions and challenges we worked through last year could have broken the partnership we've had for decades. They didn't. I foresee the partnership continuing in the future as we grow to meet our future challenges and needs. Mike, I certainly thank you for our long-standing relationship and inviting me to share my thoughts today.
Thank you, Bob, and everyone at Western for our long-standing partnership. As Bob mentioned, the decades-old relationship between Basin Electric and Western has changed. But change can be a good thing. In this instance, the ongoing changes will benefit Basin Electric and Western, and we'll continue to work together, since many of you, our members, are also Western customers. As you already know, Basin Electric is now a transmission-owning member in the Southwest Power Pool. Months and months of preparation, hundreds of employees, along with Western, Heartland, SPP, and our members, were involved in ensuring the transition was successful on October 1st. The actual go-live took place at midnight. There were a couple handfuls of us at headquarters in final preparation for the transition. Though we were prepared for the challenges with the system and the software, which were significant pieces of the integration, I'm pleased to report that the transition went rather smoothly.
We do not want any plants to trip.
Okay.
Yep. 1 minute.
1 minute.
So we have two real-time traders on tonight, and typically they're going to be covering all the markets that we're involved in. In the past, they were just covering the West, but now they'll have the whole area to work with.
Well, we're in the mode up here.
Yeah, no, we got a delay.
When we go into the market, it's going to be very important for the real-time desk to monitor what SPP is asking for out of those generation resources and where the facilities actually are at.
I'm not going to make any promises that's going to happen in the near future just because we're about to cut into SPP in 10 minutes.
The expectation tonight is for everything to go smooth and not have much to happen. We put in a lot of work to get our offers in and what's cleared in the market. And tonight, we're going to run our generation, serve our load.
So when that happens, we'll need you guys to start following the resource set point instructions immediately.
So we have a couple open phone lines going on tonight. One is with SPP and the new market participants. The other phone line that we have open is with the plants. So all the plants are on the phone line.
Yep, it's time. So
okay, go ahead, guys.
All resources should follow set point instructions given out to SPP through y'all's unique ICCP ID.
Our hope is to make the data that we have available in these systems, energy management systems specifically, a lot more transparent to the organization so Basin can make better business decisions going forward.
7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
It's a little bit of a sigh of relief, but I think that's going to be short-lived, for a few days. And so till we start seeing settlement statements and just trying to understand how our units are being dispatched and the different costs associated with them.
Well, we're in.
Woo!
That's the champagne bottles I hear talking marketing.
We made it to the finish line.
We got Diet Coke and Pepsi.
While we are operating in a new arena, Basin Electric will always retain control of how we serve our loads and operation of our assets. We're simply operating them within new rules and the day-to-day activities in this new integrated marketplace. We still intend to follow the self-supply model we've used for more than 50 years. The difference today is that we now have broad market access. In this capacity, we're able to capture new value for our members through lower purchase power costs and new ways to capture non-member sales. We asked Carl Monroe, Executive Vice President of Operations and Chief Operating Officer at SPP, to provide a few comments regarding the transition.
Little Rock and Southwest Power Pool. I want to thank you for the opportunity to share a few words at your annual meeting and regret that I cannot attend in person to share how honored we are to have you as members of Southwest Power Pool. It has been a pleasure getting to know Paul and all of your marvelous team. I want to thank everyone for your hard work and dedication to successfully integrate and help SPP and its members, including y'all, to get the benefits expected. Reliability is job one for us. Above all else, we work to ensure a reliable supply of electricity to our and your customers. Basin has a proud history of powering rural America for more than 50 years, and Southwest Power Pool will celebrate its 75th anniversary next year. Our successes as organizations are largely due to the very same cooperative values. We accomplish much by forging strong relationships with our members who come from many different sectors of the electric industry. Those diverse perspectives of our members make our organization stronger and more effective. We realize that joining a regional transmission organization represents a significant shift in the way you do business. I am confident by working together, we can meet any challenge to ensure we deliver value to your members. I hope you have a great meeting. Please know that you're always welcome to enjoy our Southern hospitality in Little Rock at our Operations Center and corporate office. Thanks, and I hope to see you soon.
Getting to the October 1st go-live was not an easy feat. It took determination. Employees and departments and divisions across the cooperative spent the last year and a half preparing the cooperative for operating in the SPP market short-term, daily, and hour-by-hour. I want to extend a special personal thank you to the entire Basin team who helped on the SPP effort. Since May, when we began what was called market trials, we've completed hundreds of hours of simulated exercises so that we could learn what we needed to do in the market under many circumstances. One of the key factors through all of it has been in the development of a strong communication between the marketing group and plant operators at all the Basin family facilities. In late August and early September, the plant communication process rolled out with the plant operators. Moving into SPP is a whole new way of working. Historically, the operators would get a call from Western once every hour or few hours when resources needed to be dispatched or backed down. In SPP, it's different. There's no longer a phone call. We have migrated, for the most part, to communicating dispatch instructions via software. That signal is now given once every 5 minutes for most assets, and in some cases, once every 4 seconds for qualified resources. It's a much more constant communication that allows more economic dispatch of Basin Electric's assets. As with all areas of the integration, training has been so important. The effectiveness of communication between the power plants and marketing will determine how effective we operate in the market. It's key. Thus far, the training and joint sessions between the plants and marketing have paid off, and the plants are performing extraordinarily in this new market. The same night as our SPP integration, the marketing and asset management team began 24/7 scheduling for Wyoming Municipal Power Agency on the west side of our system. WMPA is the wholesale electricity provider for 8 public power communities in Wyoming. Our team also continued a long-standing relationship with North Iowa Municipal Electric Cooperative Association, or NYMECA. NYMECA serves 13 municipal electric utilities. Both WMPA and NYMECA have shared interests in generation resources that Basin Electric manages and provide efficiencies for all of us. We look forward to providing quality services and value for these organizations while realizing value for you, the members, as well. We are just beginning operations in SPP, and we haven't even been able to fully implement all the new strategies we hope to execute within the market operation. We're integrating a sizable system into an already sizable operation. Understandably, we want to ensure we take measured steps to ensure success and only pursue activities that add value to the membership. One of the great benefits of our SPP integration is the ever-broadening diversity of our joined systems. As you heard John already say, our system has only grown more diverse over the last decade. SPP's system is also diverse. It provides a backstop for energy supply. In a seemingly short amount of time, Basin Electric has been able to get all its market operations under one roof. Considering how large our cooperative system is, that's something to be very proud of. It was done meticulously and with service to our members as the first priority. From the second floor at Basin Electric headquarters, we serve loads and operate assets in four different power markets or regions, 24/7, 365 days a year. As I mentioned in my presentation last year, we also co-located the Basin Electric Marketing Group with Dakota Gas's commodity marketing functions so that we could manage our collective obligations and assets day by day and hour by hour from one central location. This year, we took steps to better integrate the marketing functions. There are definite synergies in managing commodity exposures across the collective cooperative versus operating in silos. Part of the role of the cooperative is as a commodity production organization for the benefit of our members. The commodities we produce can have significant price swings. Natural gas being the most volatile of all, and we have seen price swings of more than 500%. It's prudent to keep all of our marketing functions together. These swings in prices can lead to significant financial challenges. Dakota Gas is operating in an environment of very low energy pricing that is out of the plant's control. We must remain very diligent with execution of our strategies over the next 2 years. Natural gas and oil markets are oversupplied, and this will take time for the supply and demand picture to rebalance. All the marketing staff is keenly aware of the challenges we face and is focused on finding every dollar of value we can for Dakota Gas. Steps are being taken daily to look for new opportunities to save on expenses and to generate new revenue. In this challenging atmosphere, we are finding new ways to help stabilize revenues and expenses by looking at how we manage rail agreements and fuel surcharges, how we get price certainty for ammonia sales, and how we manage the pipeline capacity that we own to move Dakota Gas production of natural gas. Dakota Gas has added tremendous value for the membership over the years, and our goal is to continue that relationship. With the development of a urea facility at Dakota Gas, which we'll hear about more tomorrow from Matt Greek in the Supporting Growth and Innovation presentation, Stephen Liebelt, Dakota Gas Vice President of Marketing and Sales, explains in this video how they've been working to develop the urea market as well as the ammonia sales activity this spring.
Our main goal from the marketing department for Dakota Gasification is to make sure that we find a market and a high-value market for all of the co-products that we produce. Our goal is to try to find customers and marketplaces that will pay the maximum value for these products in order to maintain the best margin and availability for our customers. Urea in our area is a commodity that's used quite regularly, okay? It's a substitute for nitrogen as far as ammonia, so you can use urea instead of ammonia, anhydrous ammonia. And so marketplace in our area is continuing to grow. So from our customers' perspective, they're really excited about us seeing us build this plant because we're going to have product now in this market closer to them so that they can eliminate some of the transportation issues they normally have in spring season and getting the material to the needed area on a timely basis. One of the things that our marketing team is doing is we're working with our customers to look at what makes the most sense to keep our freight costs down and the freight movement at best possible to move the product in season and out of season. We are negotiating contracts today. We have not finalized any contract. We are waiting a little bit more until our plant gets a little bit further along so we know exactly the timeline to make sure our timelines match with our contracts. We don't want to get our contracts at such that we have an obligation to deliver before we have enough material to meet those contractual obligations. Anhydrous ammonia is one of the largest co-products that we market out of the plant from a value standpoint. The other ones that are also good value are CO2. As you know, though, there's synthetic natural gas is usually the largest volume and value material, but due to the pricing of the natural gas, the fertilizers and chemicals have a greater value in today's marketplace. the spring in April, May, the team out there, including marketing, operations, accounting, security, everybody worked well together to complete the spring season. And in April, May, we moved about 90,000 tons out of the plant, which was a very, very good spring for April, May time period. A normal spring will yield us sometimes in those 2 months anywhere from that 60,000 to maybe 70,000 tons during those periods, okay? This year was a very good spring, like I said earlier, and our teamwork was very good to get it delivered on a timely basis.
There is great diversity in our cooperative family. By collectively looking at the commodities within the whole cooperative, including our subsidiaries, we're able to manage, maximize, and hedge our resources to create added value and mitigate risk. Creating one central marketing function and full integration in SPP is helping us do that. We're now able to get power where it's needed, when it's needed, as well as help us monetize excess energy. Achieving operational excellence doesn't happen by accident. It's a commitment. As John said at the beginning of our presentation, it's a commitment to our employees, our vast and diverse resources, our cooperative and safety cultures, and our existing and new partnerships. It's a commitment to you that we will do everything we can to ensure that we continue to provide low-cost, reliable electricity, no matter what external pressures try to dictate. Ultimately, we are people working to create and deliver power with one purpose in mind, to serve you, our members. Thank you.